Selamat sore Bapak dan Ibu. Good afternoon ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to today's Jurisdiction Collective Action Forum First Dialogue. Thank you for joining. Hopefully you can stay with us and enjoy the discussion for the next 2 hours. Do share your thoughts and questions anytime in the Q&A box. Also, do use the translation function to comfortably enjoy either in Bahasa or in English. Over to you, Pak Rizal, to open.
Thank you, Milka. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for being with us today. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Salam sehat dan sejahtera untuk kita semua. And also welcome to all speakers, moderators, responders, guests, and partners. Yeah. Thank you for attending the first Jurisdiction Collective Action Forum, or we called it JCAF, for and on behalf of JCAF partners consisting of CSP, Philanthropy Indonesia, IBCSD, IDH, IPK Center, Landscape Indonesia, LTKL, Peace Agro, and TFA. We thank you for your presence. And also we welcome other partners who would like to join the partnership that would enable building a larger and stronger impact collectively to advance jurisdictional approach. The agenda of today's dialogue will start with, supposedly it will start with Pak Harifin Rudianto, the Deputy Minister of from Bappenas, but he will be late coming to the session. So we will start with the scene setting from the deep dive study that TFA and Diameter developed to highlight the state of jurisdiction approach in Southeast Asia. We will then continue with a deep dive discussions. The first panel will be on the business case for jurisdiction approach. We have here already with us all the panelists and moderator. And then after the first panel discussion finishes, we will have Harifin Rudianto to give his keynote address to all of us. Yeah. And then after that, it's going to be followed by the second panel on strengthening the enabling environment for jurisdiction approach. We will then have a reflection from producer, business and financial enabler, governance, as well as international perspective. And then we will close the session and identify the next steps of the Jurisdiction Collective Action Forum. Ladies and gentlemen, there have been significant number of successes in jurisdiction approaches being implemented across jurisdiction, both in Indonesia and Malaysia. However, along the intervening years, we also understand that there are remaining gaps needs to be addressed, particularly from the perspective of investment, policies and regulation and capacity building. The Jurisdiction Collective Action Forum brings constructive dialogue in pursuit of strengthening collaboration, co-creation, and collective action, or we call it gotong royong, among various stakeholders. The objective is to create an open and safe environment for all stakeholders to share lessons learned and best practices to overcome various sustainability and investment challenges, as well as to promote collective action in pursuit of accelerating the shared agenda. So, without further ado, I would like to invite Bapak Sahat Aritonang, the Deputy Director of Diameter, to take the floor and to provide us with the context on the state of jurisdictional approach. The floor is yours, Pak Sahat. Thank you.
Thanks, Pak Rizal, for the introduction, and maybe someone can share my slide. And thanks everyone for joining this session. I'm Sahat Aritonang from Diameter, and I would like to share maybe as a warming up session on the outlook of the state of jurisdictional approach from the decade of the progress study. Can someone share the screen? Sorry. Okay, on the way. Yeah, thank you. This is kind of a highlight of the study. We call it as a decade of progress toward eliminating deforestation in Indonesia and Malaysia. has been conducted by the emitter and TFA to learn three key areas where we want to learn what kind of areas of progress, and then what are the drivers of progress and what kind of future priorities. I call it always as a homework in the future, but I will explain a little bit later in over the next slide. And this study is combined interviews, surveys, and virtual convenings. Maybe most of you or some of you already part of the convening session that we had in last year, and also including our desktop research and engaging with diverse local, national, and international stakeholders. We identified and described 12 key areas of progress and the drivers behind this. And for your information, the report will be published by the end of September 2021, which is next month, during the next dialogue. Next, please. Okay, yeah, I just want to highlight what kind of areas of progress in here. We found like 12 areas of progress, but I just want to highlight some key areas where the progress has been made. First, the deforestation is decreased, as we know, since 2015 in Indonesia, and in parallel, also wildfires also decreased. There are some factors to contribute this, but later on I will explain it. And the other progress is development of social forestry is significantly increased in the past decade. Next. Yeah, if we looking the other progress is the emergence of jurisdictional approach, especially in Indonesia. From Sumatra, Kalimantan, through Sulawesi, and more recently in Papua, leaders have emerged to work proactively to forge a shared vision for sustainable green development, including a focus on building sustainable community supply chain. The priorities and focus areas of this jurisdictional approach efforts is vary one location to the next, but they share in common a commitment to working collaboratively and develop lasting partnership for transformation and make policy and make regulatory change that apply across entire jurisdiction for the long term, not just by individual supply chain. Next. And what are the major drivers of this progress? First, if we learn from what we learned during the study is that there are major factors contributing to this progress. First, the enabling policy environment. Government of Indonesia consolidated and strengthened policies and programs at central and regional levels that promote transition toward more sustainable land use. This is also emergence of jurisdictional approach. And then the second one is the private sector and civil society action. Policy environment was leveraged by business throughout their supply chain, and the civil society action through advocacy and solution to reduce deforestation and fires and to mainstream the wider sustainability goals are also a driver to this progress. And then the third one, the market transformation. Growth in market recognition and reward to sustainable products strengthened the business case for sustainability and reinforced producer effort to make higher with low impact production to the norm. And then the next one is the knowledge transformation. This is also, we learned that there are massive expansion in the knowledge, tools, resources, and expertise on sustainable palm oil and also pulp and paper to enable advocates in industry and others to address barriers in sustainability more effectively. And then the last one, which is more the most important, is the web of synergy among these factors. As you can see at the diagram, how different actors potentially influence the sustainability decision of producer and drive progress towards sustainable and deforestation-free commodity and supply chain. The detail it will be shown in the report. I will not explain this diagram, but as you can see, the web, the different actors with different intervention contribute to this kind of like drivers of progress. Next, please. And then the last, maybe this is not the last, this is what we call as the homework. We identified six kind of like priority areas for action for coming decade, all of which can be advanced as part of emerging jurisdictional approach efforts. First, further focus on reducing deforestation and fires through direct action to affect decision by parties responsible for deforestation and indirect action to lessen underlying drivers behind deforestation and fires. Second, is overcome indicate government has opportunity to expand and consolidate policy reform further to make permanent the progress made on the deforestation and fires and on recognition of community rights. Jurisdiction, again, jurisdiction approach is especially important here. If you see the third one, concern about anticipating global market trends. Concern raised over market trend center on impact and growth in market demand that does not require sustainability, and how this can motivate producer to expand production even into forest and peat. The goal here should be to encourage even faster growth in the market segment that encourage and reward sustainability. JA partners can support this effort, especially buyers. The fourth one, especially with the smallholder, addressing livelihood and sustainability concern for palm oil smallholder is top priority in coming decade, especially increasing farmer productivity and incomes, professionalized farmer enterprise management, build social infrastructure, expand formal access to the finance, and mitigate the risk of undesirable social and poor environmental outcomes. This can be all addressed via effective smallholder programs as part of jurisdictional approach, which we already seeing in the most jurisdictional approach before. And then the number five is how to accelerating progress on social performance. The overarching goals of action to improve social accountability are to build force that first increase pressure to improve social performance, facilitate and support improvements through provision of tools, approach and technologies that elevate visibility on the issues, and most critically is the third one is reward the improvements. We think jurisdictional approach effort that build strong social programs will be needed to make progress here, as the social issues are inherently local. And the last one, reaching the small and medium producers, there's a growing attention on the need to better and reaching a small medium producer. The overarching goals in here is to strengthen sources and forms a pressure to improve sustainability performance. And the last one is again, reward improvements when they occur. And again, jurisdictional approach can play especially important role here through working with the local agencies, buyers, and producers to implement sustainability across producers of all size. And then the last one, specifically to the jurisdictional approach, the study actually in general provides a framework of collective achievement, but yet there remain priorities of action need to be scaled up. Developing a case studies to capture evidence-based best practice models in respective jurisdiction are urgently needed. There are some key areas that for the future that under the jurisdictional approach. First is to deliver on value proposition for district to achieve impact. And then the second one, bring attention and focus to the hotspot jurisdiction where deforestation and fires remain a problem. And then the last one is the incentive and rewards from the private and public sector. I think this is my last slide, and this is thank you for your attention. And we hope this presentation can be as a warming up for us before we go to the next session and as first series of this dialogue. Thank you.
Thank you, Pak Sahat Aritonang, which he emphasizes the engagement of non-party stakeholders, such as local government, private sectors, and civil societies, are key toward a successful jurisdictional approach. The Southeast Asia region, and specifically in Indonesia, has taken significant steps in the land use sector to reduce emissions by instituting various policies and regulations, such as moratorium on clearing of primary forests and reducing deforestation and forest degradations, restoring ecosystem functions, as well as sustainable management of forests. We will now go into the first panel session for a deep dive. Let me first introduce our great moderator, Mbak Gita Syahrani. She is the head of secretariat from Lingkar Temu Kabupaten Lestari, to take us through the sessions on the business case for jurisdictional approach. Mbak Gita, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Pak Rizal, as well as Bang Sahat. I hope everybody can hear my voice clearly. If yes, thumbs up. Yes. Okay. So it's a pleasure to actually welcome this panel as a follow-up to what Bang Sahat have communicated with us in terms of actually answering the word, what's in it for us? Essentially, building a business case for jurisdictional approach is one of the most important aspects to answer before we actually embark on the journey together. Now, for the panel itself, we have esteemed colleagues joining us. We have Ms. Perpetua George. Hi, Pep. She is the General Manager Group for Sustainability in Wilmar. And she will be explaining from the private sector perspective, is there any business case actually to pursue jurisdictional approach as a new approach and a more innovative approach towards sustainability? Then we are joined by Mas Fitrian Ardiansyah, the Global Envoy for Nature-Based Solutions and also the Executive Chairman and Founder of Yayasan Initiative Dagang Hijau in Indonesia. Hi, Mas Fitrian. I hope you're recovering well from the accident. I see you're smiling already, so it's a good sign. And we also have my former, and this is actually the man that introduced me to all of this ecosystem, which is Mas Agus Hari, my first boss in sustainability, the Chief Executive Officer of Landscape Indonesia. Hi, Mas Agus. All right. So now that everybody's ready, this is time for each of the panelists to deliver their 5-minute statement. And afterwards, we will be discussing some of your questions. So feel free to actually put your questions in the Q&A box, and we will be addressing it after the panel deliver their speech. So we'll start with Pep first. The time and floor is yours for the next 5 minutes. If there's 30 seconds left, I will appear again. And just as a reminder.
Thanks, Gita. Thanks so much again to the TFA, I think, for inviting me here in this session. So I represent Wilmar, which is, you know, we're quite a big palm trader and merchandiser. We have about 300,000 hectares of plantation and 100,000 employees globally. And, you know, we're plantation based. We're not very big. I think we're not, you know, we're not even I think in the top five. However, I think where we come in is very much, you know, through the trading and the downstream side. And so really our involvement in the jurisdictional approaches has very much come in from, I think, our interest in looking at, I think, one, the economies of scale, and two, is addressing this issue of how do you address inclusivity within certification, right? And I think this has always been the conundrum of certification, right? Certification is by design an exclusive approach, meaning, you know, you've got standards, you need to come in, you need to be able to apply those standards, you need to put resources in to achieve a certain standard, you are assessed, and, you know, effectively, you got to do some things, you got to pass a test, and then you either pass or you fail, right? That's the certification approach. The whole concept of certification does mean that you have a natural kind of split, I think, within the industry. You have the companies that perhaps are the first movers that are able to put in, perhaps, you know, the bigger companies who have started working on this a little bit earlier. And for those companies, you know, Wilmar included, there was that ability in the early days, you know, and we're talking the early 2000s, to really push forward the agenda to sort of, you know, in a way, start to look at how you develop these methodologies and the processes. What we've come to see is that process of having this exclusive approach will mean that as a result of the process, that you will get a component of the industry not able to make it, right? And so this is where the question often talks about, you know, is it fair for smallholders? Is certification fair? Is this the approach, etc.? And so the jurisdictional approach, our belief very much in the right jurisdictions, and this is quite important, jurisdictional approaches don't work anywhere, right? It has to be very specific areas where you have a sort of tied supply base that will allow for that value proposition to to make sense with the whole effort of moving in with the economies of scale. And so for Wilmar, really, I think for us, we are at the moment very heavily involved in the Sabah jurisdictional process. And again, it's because of the geopolitical situation. So geographically, you know, it is the second biggest state in Malaysia. It's about 7.4 million hectares. I'm from Sabah, so it's a bit embarrassing that I said it was the third biggest. It's the second biggest. 7.4 million hectares. It's about the size of Scotland. You know, so it's not small, you know, as numbers in terms of people, you know, there's about, 4 million people roughly. So 4 million people there. GDP of about $20 million a year. And of that, 30% is coming from agriculture. But again, if you know where Sabah is, and that's on the island of Borneo, it's at the very tip, North Kalimantan at the south, to the sort of west, southwest, you have Brunei and the state of Sarawak. So it's sort of, the rest of it is oceans, right? And the South China Sea. And within Sabah, you have the plantation base, you have, you know, the milling base, you have the refinery base, and you have a direct export link, right? So this, in our view, this is where jurisdictional approaches really come into play, because this is where, one, I think you get the benefit of allowing the state government to be looking at issues that have been very difficult to handle at individual unit level or even smallholder level. And that's things to do with, for example, the high conservation value HCS elements, because that very much benefits looking at a landscape level, the issue of compensation where that comes about, but also the issue of free prior informed consent and how you sort of allocate land rights. All those can be benefited or can be actually dealt with in much greater value and ability at government level. So, and if you think about it, if you just really take it very simply, if you take the various certification standards and you strip out the bits that are what I call difficult, right? Difficult for agriculture planters, right? So that's the ethic stuff, it's the conservation stuff. If you strip that out, actually what you're left with in the standard is really best practice. And best practice stuff can be dealt with.
Just a reminder, 30 seconds left.
Oh yeah, I'm almost done. And if you strip that away at unit level, it's best management practice. So you really have the ability to put that in that effort. And so where you have a sort of scenario where you have the economies of scale, and you have that direct export ability and the supply chain all tied there, it's a win-win scenario. And so that's why for us, it makes a lot of sense. And I guess in the last few seconds, what I will say is, it isn't a silver bullet though. So it's not gonna work everywhere. And so it's really important to look at where the supply chain links to the economies of scale in order for it to become a success. So that's my piece. Thank you so much, Gita.
Thank you so much. I was sort of mesmerized with the last part of the statement, actually, in terms of separating the difficult part of certification and actually making that the one of the main reason for people to actually get together and solve the difficult part, so that it creates more inclusivity. So thank you for that. And I think one of the consistent advocate for inclusivity to make sure that stakeholders are working together and they're actually acknowledging each other's role and supporting each other is IDH. And I'd like to actually give the second floor to Mas Fitrian from IDH to deliver again a 5-minute speech, and I will remind you when there's 30 seconds left. Thanks, Mas.
Thank you so much, Gita, and also thank you, TFA, for inviting us, IDH. Hopefully somebody can help me sharing the screen, but while waiting, I would love to say also thank you to Pap, because I think she has made a very good point. That we can't do this everywhere. We have to do this kind of jurisdiction approach in specific areas. If we go to the next slide, before even talking about developing a certain jurisdictions as a good jurisdictional approach, I think we have to acknowledge that this cannot be done if there's no good regulatory or policy framework. That is why, for instance, with IDH and partners, we certainly work closely with the government, especially the provincial and the district government, to develop such regulatory framework, you know, starting with, for instance, among others, the development of green growth plan, because this would then give signals to private sector like Wilmar and others that such jurisdiction is serious in developing sustainable commodities, verified commodities in you know, the sourcing area or landscapes that they're working on, with also the inclusion of smallholders and different stakeholders, like you also said, Gita. But of course, this kind of plan of green growth plan and policy will not be effective or functional if there's no effort to mainstream this into, let's say, midterm development policy or plan, program planning or annual program plan or annual plan of the government. And of course, more importantly, translated into the budget. As you know, in Indonesia and many other countries, if there's no budget, there won't be any operational and also supports on the ground. So it would be quite important to have this kind of combination of policy and budget. But of course, then you have to be able to have agreements or a certain agreement among small stakeholders to have certain objectives to achieve. In our cases, in different areas, in Sumatra, Kalimantan, and Papua, for instance, stakeholders try to dialogue, to have a dialogue and also discuss, let's say, key objectives of KPI related to improved productivity or production of certain commodities, including for instance, palm oil, rubber, coffee, cocoa, and of course, the elements of KPIs on protections, how many hectares of forest that we need to protect and also conserve and maintain sustainably, peatland, mangroves, and so on. And more importantly, also, the inclusion of smallholders and villages. We don't want to have both productivity and protection only to benefit, let's say, government and all, big companies. So we have to also include smallholders and villages because the livelihood, the welfare of them is quite critical. And then, of course, translating from this kind of agreement, what we call PPI agreement or PPI compact, then we can develop what we call the system of connecting producers or growers with the buyers. And in many areas that we have been working, we started by developing what's so-called verified sourcing areas, Gita, linking growers and big buyers or traders, the like of Unilever, PepsiCo, Musimas, and many others, because I think it will be so critical for the buyers to talk directly with the growers with the endorsement and support of local governments. What sort of appetite, what sort of requirements need to be translated on the ground so that they or their productivity or their production or their products, their commodities can be accepted in the market. And then with that knowledge that can be translated on the ground. And of course, then we can identify certain gaps, and such gaps usually require investment. Organizations like IDH and the private sector can provide initial fund, but I think lots of costs associated with this would then be surely needing investment or capital coming from our financial institutions. That's why I think even since the get-go, we need to bring onto the table certain financial institutions like the banks and investment funds or impact investors. So we can do some sort of blended finance to support both smallholders, small to medium companies, and also local government. The cases on, in Aceh, the cases in West Kalimantan, the cases in different areas in Indonesia, be it supported by IDH or supported by different organizations like in Siak and Riau, for instance. It is clear that we need to have that kind of connections of growers, buyers, and also the system needs to have that kind of transparency, Agita, and the dialogue needs to also connect to translating or to have that kind of translations of requirement. And what I also learned, or not I, but our organization learned, is needs to have a governance structures on the ground. In the case of Sumatra, like in Aceh and in South Sumatra, you've got PUPL or PUKL, which is the Center of Excellence of Commodities. In different areas, you also got different type of Center of Excellence led by the Bupati, supported by stakeholders. Last but not least, this is the structure of finance that needs to be there, crafted to support both investment needed or finance needed to address enabling environment, because most enabling environment would require finance that cannot be linked to commercial investment, you know, addressing or supporting land legality, for instance, strengthening farmers' organizations, prototyping input and fertilizers, and so on and so forth, and different type of different type of technical assistance. But then, of course, after that, farmer organization, small to medium enterprises, and different intervention need to graduate to be part of the portfolio or pipeline of commercial investment. So, great. With the connection of growers, smallholders, off-takers, and financiers, and of course, highly supported or frequently supported by the local government, we do hope this can be used as prototype, and this model can be replicated in different areas, not only in Indonesia, but also, like Pep mentioned, in Sabah, in different areas across the globe. I thank you, Rigita. Hopefully, we can have a good discussion. Over to you.
Thank you, Mas Fitrian, and thank you also for highlighting the different types of modalities that's already there running on the ground to actually give a more structured approach towards gathering collective actions where everybody actually know who's doing what, where, by when, but essentially working together toward a common goal. Now, speaking of common goal, we'd like to actually invite Mas Agusari from Landscape Indonesia to actually discuss about essentially what are the common goals when it comes to investment opportunities for jurisdictional approach. Again, another 5 minutes and I'll remind you when there's 30 seconds left. Go ahead, Mas Agus.
Thank you very much, Gita. It's very, very nice to be here and to be amongst you. Good afternoon, everybody. I would like to talk a little bit about my past life as CEO of Blantara Foundation. I remember when I tried to convince, at the time it was, the Sinarmas Group, APP, Open Paper, APP group of companies, to carry out what was called basically landscape approach, and I would say jurisdictional approach is practically landscape approach in within jurisdictional boundaries. There were two questions that I asked them, and that I eventually asked them everyone else at a time, was that first, would you be willing to co-manage and also co-finance landscape management in where you are, especially since you only occupy a very, very small portion, a very, very small part of a very large jurisdiction. At the time, basically the landscape was about 10 times bigger than their typical concessions. And then the second question I asked them was whether you can afford not to. And the answers were very interesting. The first question was yes. And quite a lot basically was of companies. When I asked that, they basically said yes, because they are not able to actually do everything within a landscape. They need to work together, not only with their own stakeholders and their own immediate stakeholders, but also other companies within the same jurisdiction, within the same landscape, and also stakeholders that are, pretty far away in distance from where they are. Simply because the ecosystem of the landscape, this ecosystem of jurisdiction is entirely intertwined. Whether they can afford not to, I mean, that's basically the defining question, because if they don't do that, they will basically risk their future business. And that's when they answered, no, we cannot afford not to manage the jurisdiction. That's actually finally accepted our proposal to invest about $50 million at the time to co-manage the landscape. And that's a huge amount of money, and it didn't come from CSR budget. It comes from another budget. For them, it is considered as risk management. And eventually, you know, within the jurisdiction, within the landscape, many other companies follow suit, and you know, it becomes what you know, a group of companies co-managing the same landscape. So that is basically another way of what I would start when we are talking about how to finance jurisdictional approach. What needs to be seen is that we need to see how we can consolidate a lot of interests. There's one interest in the commodity supply chain, and there's another interest of zeroing deforestation for carbon emission purposes. Those can be consolidated, and all those efforts can have their own financing. Landscape approach or jurisdictional approach for commodity companies would be seen as basically reducing the risk from the sourcing area, engaging in landscape approach and seek multi-stakeholder collaboration to do that, right? Whereas reduction of deforestation and reduction of emissions, they're seeing it as basically increasing ecosystem integrity of the emission reduction. Now, how can we continue financing it?
A quick reminder, yes. 30 seconds left.
Oh my God, we only have 5 minutes, I remember. Give me a little break here. A number of things. One is that you need to see financing jurisdictional approach as financing regional development. You cannot only see it as investing in private entities. And as such, you need to blend private and public financing. And there are a number of ways of doing it, including, and I would like to bring up the idea of bringing institutions like BPDLH into the regions, into the provinces and into the kabupatens, and have them manage the financial requirements of the region. As such, you can actually mix the private and public financing, and also some modalities through bonds and even sukuk at the provincial and kabupaten level. I think I will stop there. Thank you.
Thank you. And we stopped at a very interesting junction of looking at whether jurisdictional approach can actually be seen as investing on regional development, which is an interesting question. And it's related to also things that are already there in the Q&A box. Now I would love to ask all of the panelists to join me again, and we'll start the Q&A session. There's a couple of questions already here, and probably we'll go from the first question that is directed to Mas Fitrian. So this is from Pak Aman, and the question is, in terms of actually looking at implementing supply chain transformation between supply chain approach to jurisdictional approach, do you think this can be implemented across different types of commodity supply chain? And also, can it be something that is really linking directly between different jurisdictions? So for example, can it connect West Kalimantan with Sarawak and Sabah, being both jurisdictions that are committed to sustainability?
Thank you, Gita. This is so interesting to answer. I don't know whether I have the answers, of course. Nevertheless, I would start by saying there's no one silver bullet, of course, but the different commodities have uniqueness in each individual commodity. Nevertheless, they also have similar challenges and similar characteristics when it comes to supply chains and meeting sustainability standards. In many ways, if you look at coffee, cocoa, palm oil, rubber in Indonesia alone, you tend to find that smallholders, I'm talking now relatively you know, focusing on smallholders, they're facing a low level of productivity. So certain technical assistance for good agriculture practices, be it for rubber, coffee, and cocoa, this is needed. So certain centers of excellence can provide that. Of course, technical assistance for coffee would be different to cocoa, but at least, you know, in general, that kind of good agricultural practices requirement would be needed. Structure for input financing also would be needed, or even you know, financing for eventually replanting would be needed. So it is quite in general, it's quite similar in terms of challenging. Support for shaping and also strengthening farmers' organizations and changing or transforming this farmers' organization into a good business model is also quite similar. If you don't have a business model for farmers, you can't have farmers that are productive and profitable and also meeting sustainability standards. So that's usually the requirement. And we can talk about many different things. Yeah. So that's in general the similarities. Of course, then you have, again, like I mentioned earlier, certain uniqueness. So local government, private sectors, and organization like us and many others can help in seeing the connection or the thin red line of those similar challenges that we can support in you know, a scale of the jurisdictions, and we can structure it. But if we talk about linking jurisdictions from one to another, it depends so much on, I think, the characteristic of those jurisdictions as well, and also the appetite of the buyers, and of course the logistics. Yeah. In many ways, if the buyers see that the logistics is relatively easier, let's say Aceh and Sumatra, that may be a feasible case to develop a connection of jurisdiction or Riau with Jambi. But if you talk about, let's say, West Kalimantan and Sarawak, geographically, this is quite okay. Yep. But politically, I don't know. I mean, Pep, you know much better than...
we'll go to Pep after this.
Malaysia and West Malaysia, I mean, you know that. So look, I don't want to pretend that I know everything, but I think that's usually the biggest challenge of all is not the content or the technical issues. It's the political and psychological issues. Thank you, Gita.
Thank you so much.
Answering the question. Thank you.
And it also gives a great segue for me to go back to Pep, since this is also about Sabah and, you know, interconnectivity between two jurisdictions. But there's also a question for you in terms of, from the perspective of private sector, looking at the types of multi-stakeholders governance that is already there and possibly working in Sabah and other area where Wilmar are operating, what type of structure do you think are quite effective? And what is it that makes company like Wilmar motivated to participate directly in that type of multi-stakeholders governance? Go ahead, Pep.
So yeah, so it's a question of governance, and I think to maybe do a different take on, I think, the response that Pak Fitrian provided, and also in a way I think responding also to the question that Pak Aman raised, right? And I'm going I'm going to stick my head out here, and I'm going to say something quite controversial, is that I don't believe jurisdictional approaches should be working with each other, right? And I say that not because I don't think there is value in sort of, you know, collaboration across, you know, political, like say, for example, Sarawak with West Kalimantan. I say this because it doesn't make sense from a supply chain perspective, right? And it's really important to take a step back, right? The jurisdictional approaches very specifically talk about a certification process, right? It's not talking about necessarily just, you know, overarching, you know, blanket level assistance to, you know, producers. It's not, it's talking about the actual production at the end of the day of certified volumes, right? If you look at the only jurisdictional approach sort of standard that's currently out there, it's still draft, the RSPO one, they don't even talk about supply chain stuff yet. There is no way to talk about if you are a supplier that is, and I'll give an example, if a specific district is certified, right? And you've got maybe producers in that district. And because the jurisdiction approach doesn't clarify how you're going to manage the supply chain, what happens when that, if we talk about palm oil, when that fruit then goes, say, to a mill in another district that's not under jurisdiction, right? What then happens, right? There will be no claim. The mill that's in another jurisdiction can't claim for what's being produced as certified there. So because of that, because of the supply chain complexities, that's why my beginning statement, my main message today is jurisdictional approaches don't work for everywhere. It works really in very specific instances where you have total control of the supply chain, right? And this is why, in my view, right now, Sabah is quite an ideal, in an ideal position, because there is no interborder trade. If we're, especially if we're talking about palm, there's no interborder trade, right?
Okay.
The plantations, and that's partly because of the terrain, you know, between, you know, where Sabah is, where it intersects with Sarawak and Kalimantan in that region, is very, you know, super hilly, very difficult to go through. There is very, very little. There might be, you know, a few FFBs that maybe come across, but very, very minimal, not to the extent where you can actually call it trade, because there is no cross-border trade, because you have between the plantations to the mill, to the refinery, and then from the refineries exporting out in Sabah, enclosed within the state, enclosed within a single jurisdiction. You can do this. There is economical value in doing jurisdictional approaches there, right? And that's why, to me, I think it doesn't make sense to think about, well, okay, if we're going to be jurisdictionally certified in somewhere in West Kalimantan, can we then sell it over to Sarawak? No, you can't, because it makes it very difficult to claim. What can you claim? Who's going to get the end benefit, right? Not clear. And that is also the same, my same response to that question about, you know, when you look at maybe the forests that intersect, you know, and how do you then look at that from a jurisdiction approach? Well, I think for Borneo, it's been tried before, right? Heart of Borneo, ring a bell, anybody? You know, where the governments came together, you know, Brunei, Sarawak, Sabah, Kalimantan, Indonesia, right? And, you know, every year there is sort of a discussion on this, and everybody means well, but like, you can't do anything because all the governments have to agree.
Right.
And so to me, you can't do anything if you have multiple people in the driver's seat effectively, right? So to me, like, what's important is if you really want to move this whole, you know, economies of scale, it has to be in the right jurisdiction and it has to have one driver. It cannot have multiple people, because then you end up having like a forever talk shop where nothing gets done, right? And I think lots of places we're in danger of that. So that would be my, you know, possibly quite controversial view, but it is, you know, absolutely what I, after the last few years, I think this is, you know, where I seriously believe this is where we really need to pin down what is important when it comes to jurisdictional approaches.
Great. I mean, the closing statement is spot on. Let's not do forever talk shop. And in that regard, we have the last 3 minutes. We'll give it to Pak Agus to answer a couple of questions. I'll make it summarized. So two questions, Mas Agus. You mentioned, you know, jurisdictional approach and landscape approach are two things that can actually be synergized. And this is a question from Pak Nyoman when it comes to peat. And how do we look at Kahage or peat hydrological unit and in the context of both jurisdictional and landscape approach? And in terms of actually positioning it towards the investment opportunities that you just highlighted?
Yeah. Thank you, Gita. I agree that I think the key indicators is the ecosystem indicators, and as such, I think landscape approach is always probably the best way to characterize it. But at the same time, it is the government that has the authority to provide, you know, land use planning, to provide policies that would affect land users, and you know, and many other things that you know, just basically non-governmental and private sector alone would not be able to do. So the balance between how government can do it and ensuring that the ecosystem is taken into account as the first indicator is important, and that is indeed what jurisdictional approach is. And I think this is something that I think Pep just mentioned. We do need one driver, and the driver should be the government. it needs to work with, you know, different stakeholders, but it and it needs to be consultative and participatory. But the government needs to be the driving on, you know, on the driving seat. I think that, you know, depending on the level of jurisdictions, of course, you know, it could be the bupatis, the village head, the governor. Working together among private sectors may be difficult, mm-hmm. and I see where PEP is coming from, but the coordination is really important. And again, for such, the government could and probably should do that.
Thank you so much, Mas Agus, for this last statement. And we're about to move to the next session, but let me just quickly summarize what just happened in the first session. So the common word that everybody was mentioning is agree, and that's what I'm taking away from this discussion. The A stands for arguments to pursue jurisdictional approach must begin with common needs for a solution. If it's not working, then you solve it. The G stands for governance of multi-stakeholders needs to have government in the driving seat to facilitate discussions among multi-stakeholders. The R, reasons need to have business model behind it. The E stands for engine of change, and its modalities are already existing on the ground and can be replicated. You do not need to start from scratch. And the E, essentially the main question is, can you afford not to work together to achieve the common goals? So thank you very much for the opportunity. I yield the floor back to Pak Rizal. Thank you very much, everyone, and all the panelists.
Thank you, Mbak Gita, and to all the panelists, really great and enriched discussions, which clearly highlights that jurisdictional approach requires that collective action from business, financial institutions, civil societies, and clearly driven by the leadership of the subnational government to maintain the balance for thriving forests and its ecosystem, as well as sustainable economic development. Thank you to all the panelists and moderator. I heard Pa Arifin Rudianto is already with us. Thank you, Pa. Welcome, Pa Deputy Minister for Maritime and Natural Resources from the Ministry of National Development and Planning, Bappenas. Thank you very much, Pak Arifin. So I would like to give the floor to Bapak Arifin to take the floor and to provide us with the context on the state of jurisdictional approach in his keynote address. And then we will follow with the second panel discussion. The floor is yours, Pak Arifin. Thank you.
Thank you, Pak Rizal. Yang saya hormati, Mr. Justin Adam, Executive Director, Tropical Forest Alliance, Pak Rizal Al-Kamar, selaku Director Regional Asia Tenggara, Tropical Forest Alliance, World Economic Forum, and also all speakers dan hadirin yang berbahagia. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Sebelumnya saya ucapkan selamat kepada Tropical Forest Alliance yang telah menyelenggarakan pertemuan pertama Forum Aksi Kolektif Yurisdiksi pada siang hari ini. Ini sebuah upaya yang harus kita apresiasi bersama untuk mengingatkan pentingnya pelibatan dan partisipasi semua stakeholders dalam pelaksanaan pembangunan nasional. Bapak-Ibu yang kami hormati, hampir 2 tahun pandemi telah kita lalui sejak Presiden Joko Widodo mengumumkan kasus perdana COVID-19 di Indonesia. Selanjutnya kita menyaksikan bahwa pandemi ini menimbulkan beragam dampak multisektor dan menurunkan kualitas kehidupan sosial ekonomi kita. Bahkan pandemi ini mencatat kontraksi pertumbuhan ekonomi sebesar -2% pada tahun 2020 dan menyebabkan sekitar 2,5 juta kehilangan pekerjaan selama pandemi. Namun, meskipun jumlah kasus saat ini masih cukup tinggi, kini kita mulai memasuki babak baru penanganan pandemi dengan mengintensifkan pemberian vaksin COVID-19 pada seluruh warga Indonesia. Harapannya, upaya vaksinasi dengan diiringi rangkaian program pemulihan yang tengah menjadi ikhtiar kita bersama ini bisa menjadi leverage positif dalam penanganan pandemi COVID-19. Di sisi lain, masyarakat di tingkat global mulai menyadari dampak multidimensi yang ditimbulkan di masa depan akibat krisis iklim dan hilangnya keanekaragaman hayati. Jika pola hidup dan pembangunan untuk meningkatkan perekonomian dan kesejahteraan sosial masih berkutat pada pendekatan bisnis as usual yang tinggi emisi dan eksploitatif terhadap sumber daya alam, maka pendekatan ini kini menjadi semakin tidak relevan untuk menjawab berbagai tantangan pembangunan. Terlebih lagi, setelah terjadi disrupsi multisektor akibat pandemi nanti. Karenanya, kecenderungan di tingkat global saat ini mulai menjadikan isu lingkungan dan perubahan iklim sebagai arus utama kebijakan. Indonesia juga melakukannya. Dengan mengedepankan keseimbangan, pembangunan ekonomi, kesejahteraan sosial, serta secara bersamaan tetap menjaga kelestarian dan daya dukung lingkungan. Sebagai gambaran, berbagai negara kini mulai meningkatkan komitmennya untuk menurunkan emisi gas rumah kaca, seperti negara-negara di Uni Eropa, Swedia, UK, Prancis, Denmark, Hungaria, dan juga New Zealand, dan bahkan Tiongkok telah berkomitmen menetapkan target mencapai net zero emisi pada kisaran tahun 2050 sampai 2060. Pemerintah di berbagai negara juga mendorong momentum pemulihan pandemi COVID-19 ini agar menjadi bagian yang tak terpisahkan dari penanganan isu perubahan iklim dan pencapaian target-target pembangunan berkelanjutan. Indonesia juga melakukannya. Kita sudah melakukan berbagai skenario menuju net zero emission, mulai dari 2045, 2050, 2060, 2070, yang nanti akan diputuskan oleh Bapak Presiden. Kami memandang bahwa upaya pemulihan ekonomi yang disusun pemerintah perlu dipastikan agar tidak sekedar memacu pertumbuhan ekonomi jangka pendek, namun juga harus memiliki tujuan utama untuk membangun kembali dengan lebih baik, build back better. Dan tentunya tetap harus sejalan dengan upaya pencapaian SDGs. Juga telah ditegaskan oleh Bapak Presiden pada akhir tahun 2020 yang lalu, bahwa target capaian SDGs harus tetap kita penuhi melalui berbagai terobosan, baik dalam penguasaan ilmu pengetahuan teknologi maupun memanfaatkan berbagai local wisdom lainnya. Sebagai respon terhadap berbagai isu global dan nasional, pemerintah Indonesia telah menggagas konsep pembangunan rendah karbon yang merupakan salah satu platform untuk mewujudkan target-target pembangunan berkelanjutan, target SDGs. Sehingga pembangunan tidak hanya berfokus pada pertumbuhan ekonomi semata, namun juga meminimalkan dampak negatif terhadap lingkungan. Pembangunan rendah karbon dan ketahanan iklim yang juga merupakan inti dari tujuan 13 dalam SDGs menjadi sentral dalam upaya kita untuk mewujudkan SDGs dan juga mencapai target penurunan emisi gas rumah kaca pada tahun 2030. Hal ini sejalan dengan posisi isu perubahan iklim yang bersifat lintas sektor, sehingga pembangunan rendah karbon dan ketahanan iklim dapat menjadi platform nasional dengan upaya mencapai target SDGs dan juga NDC yang secara holistik dan terintegrasi didukung oleh berbagai goal lainnya di ketiga dimensi pembangunan berkelanjutan. Bapak-Ibu yang kami hormati, pembangunan rendah karbon menjadi salah satu prioritas dalam rencana pembangunan jangka menengah tahun 2020-2024. Dengan penekanan pada penanganan perubahan iklim yang sejalan dengan upaya menjaga keberlanjutan lingkungan dan stabilitas ekonomi serta sosial. Di dalam RPJMN 2020-2024, secara eksplisit, agenda pembangunan ke-6 menempatkan agenda penanganan perubahan iklim menjadi bagian agenda pembangunan Indonesia dengan target penurunan emisi gas rumah kaca yang didukung oleh pembangunan energi berkelanjutan, pemulihan lahan berkelanjutan, penanganan limbah, pengembangan industri hijau, dan perwujudan pembangunan rendah karbon di sektor pesisir dan kelautan. Pembangunan rendah karbon mengusung pendekatan berbasis sistem yang integratif di dalam merumuskan kebijakan baik di tingkat nasional maupun di daerah. Pencapaian target-target sektor dilihat dalam kacamata satu sistem yang saling terkait. Dirancang dengan memperhatikan daya dukung dan daya tampung lingkungan serta sumber daya alam yang ada. Sehingga trade-off negatif diantaranya dapat dikurangi dan ditekan agar keberlanjutan pembangunan dapat terjaga. Saat ini, dalam kerangka pembangunan rendah karbon telah dibangun pola koordinasi yang kuat antar sektor dan antar kementerian lembaga terkait, juga dengan pemerintah daerah dan lembaga non-pemerintah dalam melaksanakan dan melaporkan aksi pembangunan rendah karbon sesuai dengan target dan kontribusi masing-masing. Tentu saja, koordinasi ini perlu terus diperkuat dan ditingkatkan di masa mendatang. Pendekatan system thinking juga dikembangkan untuk mencapai ke-17 tujuan pembangunan berkelanjutan atau tujuan SDGs. Setiap tujuan dalam SDGs ini merupakan subsistem yang saling terhubung dan saling mempengaruhi. Untuk itu, kebijakan yang diusung dalam subsistem harus memperhatikan dampaknya terhadap subsistem yang lain. Dan sekali lagi, tujuan 13 yang meliputi tujuan terkait penanganan perubahan iklim yang diwujudkan dalam pembangunan rendah karbon dan perketahanan iklim menjadi penting dan menjadi sentral dalam upaya kita untuk mewujudkan keseluruhan tujuan dari SDGs. Saat ini, kami secara terus-menerus tengah melakukan analisis dampak COVID-19 terhadap berbagai target RPJMN. Mengingat dampak COVID-19 mendorong pemerintah untuk melakukan berbagai koreksi terhadap asumsi dasar dan target-target pembangunan. Sebelumnya, pemerintah telah menyusun berbagai skenario agar Indonesia dapat lepas dari middle income trap pada tahun 2036. Seiring dengan berbagai dampak yang muncul dari adanya pandemi COVID-19 ini, diperkirakan skenario tersebut menjadi sedikit terhambat. Sehingga Bappenas kini mendorong adanya transformasi ekonomi agar dapat mengembalikan jalur pembangunan seperti sebelum terjadinya COVID-19. Dalam hal ini, pemerintah telah melakukan berbagai upaya untuk menekan laju penyebaran pandemi, sekaligus memulihkan ekonomi secara bertahap. Di antaranya dengan mengalokasikan sebesar Rp685 triliun pada tahun 2020 yang lalu melalui program pemulihan ekonomi nasional, serta melakukan berbagai realokasi dan refocusing anggaran negara untuk penguatan sistem kesehatan nasional. Meskipun demikian, masih sedikit sekali program pemulihan yang dilakukan dengan mempertimbangkan dampak dan manfaat jangka panjang. Untuk itu, kami tengah melaksanakan rangkaian proses yang diharapkan dapat menjadi lompatan kebijakan pemulihan ekonomi yang berkelanjutan di masa pandemi. Di antaranya dengan melakukan upaya untuk memasukkan green fiscal stimulus sebagai bagian dari pemulihan ekonomi nasional. Fokusnya pada 3 sektor, yaitu energi baru terbarukan, perkebunan berkelanjutan, dan pengelolaan sampah. Upaya ini juga telah mendapat sambutan positif dan dukungan dari berbagai mitra pembangunan. Dari hasil studi yang kami lakukan, yang saat ini masih terus berjalan, implementasi Green Fiscal Stimulus dapat memberikan manfaat holistik dari segi ekonomi, sosial, dan lingkungan. Sebagai contoh, program revitalisasi perkebunan petani yang digagas sebagai salah satu Green Fiscal Stimulus diperkirakan dapat menciptakan hingga sekitar 150 ribu pekerjaan baru di tahun 2022 nanti, serta meningkatkan kesejahteraan 19 juta pekerja yang sudah ada. Secara bersamaan, melalui kegiatan ini juga diperkirakan dapat menurunkan 100 juta ton emisi karbon dioksida dalam kurun waktu 20 tahun. Secara bersamaan, kita juga perlu mulai membangun ketahanan di masa depan untuk mengantisipasi guncangan tidak terduga di masa mendatang, seperti halnya pandemi COVID-19 yang tengah kita alami saat ini. Kemampuan untuk beradaptasi terhadap ancaman-ancaman di masa mendatang perlu semakin kita perkuat. Hal ini dapat dilakukan melalui penguatan konvergensi antara penguatan risiko bencana dan adaptasi perubahan iklim, serta penanggulangan bencana dan peningkatan ketahanan iklim yang sejalan dengan konsep adaptive social protection. Salah satu contoh konkret dari konsep ini adalah implementasi asuransi pertanian yang dapat membantu petani dalam memitigasi risiko bencana seperti banjir, kekeringan, dan bencana alam lainnya. Model asuransi ini dapat direplikasi pada komunitas lain yang rentan terhadap bencana, termasuk bencana yang diakibatkan oleh perubahan iklim. Untuk jangka yang lebih panjang lagi, pembangunan rendah karbon dan ketahanan iklim akan menjadi salah satu platform penting dalam rencana pembangunan jangka panjang nasional 2025-2045 yang saat ini baru mulai diinisiasi oleh Bappenas, di mana mencakup asesmen terhadap rencana jangka panjang dalam konteks pembangunan rendah karbon dan ketahanan iklim. Kami berharap framework ini terus diperkuat dan digaungkan baik di tingkat pusat maupun di daerah, dan diperkuat oleh dukungan semua pihak. Seiring dengan berbagai upaya tersebut, saat ini kita telah memasuki satu dekade menuju tahun 2030 untuk mewujudkan SDGs. Tentu diperlukan peran aktif, prakarsa, dan inovasi dari seluruh pemangku kepentingan, seluruh stakeholders, agar Indonesia dapat tetap adaptif terhadap dinamika global, dan juga agar kita tidak tertinggal dalam global supply chain. Karenanya penting bagi seluruh pihak untuk memiliki persepsi yang sama bahwa untuk pencapaian SDGs dan pembangunan rendah karbon ini dapat memberikan manfaat bersama atau mutual benefit. Kolaborasi dengan seluruh pihak menjadi penting untuk menciptakan daya ungkit leverage yang lebih besar, termasuk juga kerjasama dengan teman-teman dari Tropical Forest Alliance yang hadir pada saat ini. Akhir kata, pada kesempatan yang baik ini, saya ingin mengajak seluruh pihak yang hadir pada hari ini untuk melanjutkan upaya kolaboratif yang telah kita lakukan bersama, serta mempersatukan tujuan kita untuk mengembalikan jalur pembangunan Indonesia yang lebih baik, tangguh, dan berkelanjutan. Demikian yang bisa kami sampaikan. Terima kasih, tetap sehat, senyum, dan semangat. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam. Terima kasih banyak Bapak Arifin Rudianto. Very inspiring keynote address Pak Arifin. One of the messages that we need to transform from business as usual approach towards an approach that incorporates climate policies to be an integral strategy of our planning, operation, and decision-making process. And that Low Carbon Development Initiative is a development platform that aims to maintain economic and social growth through low greenhouse gas emission development activities and minimize the exploitation of natural resources. Very well taken, Pa Arifin Rudianto. Very much appreciated. Thank you so much, Papa. We will now move into the second panel session. Let me first introduce our moderator, Bapak Agus Lukman. He is the Senior Fellow of IPMI International Business School Case Center to take us through the session on strengthening the enabling environment for jurisdictional approach toward a sustainable jurisdiction. Pak Agus, the floor is yours, Pak. Thank you. You're still on mute, Pak Agus.
Thank you, Pak Rizal. I am mindful that our main of our guests are actually Indonesian, so please allow me to present and moderate in Bahasa Indonesia. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat sore, Ibu dan Bapak yang kami hormati. Sesi panel ini akan menyajikan dinamika wilayah subnasional, terutama tingkat kesiapan para pemangku kepentingan setempat. dapat memajukan pendekatan yurisdiksi sebagai suatu pembaruan model pembangunan. Dalam hal ini, kami akan perkenalkan para panelis kita yang terhormat. Yang pertama adalah Bapak Wan Muhammad Yunus. Beliau adalah Kepala Bapeda Kabupaten Siak di Provinsi Riau. Beliau akan men-share kepada kami pembelajaran dari pengembangan kebijakan khas Kabupaten Siak guna mencapai produksi komoditas yang berkelanjutan dan pembangunan rendah karbon. Kedua adalah Bapak Susanto Kurniawan sebagai lead dinamisator dengan Lembaga Sedagu Siak di Riau. Beliau akan menyajikan pembelajaran dari pengembangan kelembagaan judicial approach di Kabupaten Siak. Adapun yang terhormat Bapak Surin Supuan sebagai Direktur Asia Tenggara Proforest, beliau akan share kepada kita semua pembelajaran pendekatan yurisdiksi sebagai cara untuk keterlibatan dari rantau pasukan dalam produksi komoditas di Indonesia dan Malaysia. Bapak-Ibu sekalian, waktu dan kesempatan kami persilakan kepada yang kita hormati, Bapak Wan Muhammad Yunus, dan demi waktu mohon maaf Bapak untuk 4 menit menjelaskan pengalaman, sudut pandang, dan rekomendasinya. Terima kasih. Kami persilakan Pak Wan Muhammad Yunus. Mungkin mohon Bapak suaranya Pak. Enggak bisa. Ya. Belum bisa, Pak Wan. Mungkin Pak Wan, kalau berkenan, WA ke saya, kemudian saya akan saya tambahkan di dalam speaker saya, Pak Wan.
Halo?
Halo? Halo?
Alhamdulillah, Pak. Monggo, Pak Wan.
Ya, saya pakai HP. Ada masalah juga. Siapa?
Mungkin, ya.
Sebentar, Pak.
Baik, Pak.
Ya, makasih Pak. Jadi kami mungkin akan menyampaikan inisiatif daerah tentang Kabupaten Siak Hijau. Lanjut Pak. Next. Nah, kenapa kita perlu Siak Hijau? Yang pertama, misalnya kita melihat respon terhadap kondisi lingkungan di Kabupaten Siak. Nah, dari kondisi yang ada sekarang atau sebelumnya, itu misalnya kita lihat ada kebakaran hutan, sering terjadi kebakaran hutan. Nah, pada tahun 2015 saja, itu terjadi kebakaran hutan sekitar 2.000 hektar lebih. Nah, juga tentang kualitas air sungai, udara, dan lahan. Kemudian kalau kita lihat, lahan di Kabupaten Siak itu, gambut di Kabupaten Siak itu cukup luas, yaitu sekitar 57,3%, yaitu 9 dari 14 kecamatan. Nah, ini dalam pemanfaatannya perlu dilakukan secara terkendali dan lestari. Kemudian, untuk komitmen terhadap kelestarian lingkungan, memang sejak berdirinya Kabupaten Siak ini sudah komit terhadap lingkungan. Misalnya pada saat penyusunan tata ruang, kita sudah membuat ada keseimbangan antara kawasan budidaya dengan kawasan kehutanan maupun kawasan lindung. Kemudian di Kabupaten Siak sendiri terdapat beberapa kawasan konservasi yang masih didominasi oleh hutan alam primer. Misalnya kita lihat ada Taman Nasional Zamrud, ada Cagar Biosfer, Diam Siak Kecil, ada Suaka Margasatwa Tasik Belak di Sungai Apit, ada Tahura di Minas, Tahura Sultan Syarif Hashim. Nah, ini juga harus mendapat perhatian kita sehingga kawasan-kawasan konservasi ini tidak terancam seperti misalnya kawasan-kawasan konservasi yang ada di tempat lain. Kemudian kelima, misalnya peran serta masyarakat dan swasta. Kita lihat cukup tinggi. dalam perlindungan lingkungan hidup. Nah, kalau kita lihat beberapa perusahaan di Kabupaten Siak ini, kebanyakan sudah memiliki sertifikasi di bidang perkebunan.
Kalau mohon maaf, Pak Wan.
Ya, halo.
Mohon itu mohon di-mute mungkin komputernya, Bapak, supaya tidak echo. Mohon maaf, Bapak. Sudah di-mute ya, Pak. Ya. Silakan, Pak. Mohon maaf sekali, Pak.
Enggak, ini di volumenya, Pak. Sorry, Pak.
Baik, Pak. Silakan, Pak. Lanjut, Pak. Kita coba lagi, Pak. Bapak-Ibu sekalian, mohon maaf atas ketidaknyamanan ini. Mohon bersabar dengan kami. Please bear with us. Thank you.
Halo.
Silakan, Pak. Ya, Pak.
Ya, yes, makasih. Maaf ini ada
apa-apa sedikit.
Maklum jawab. Misalnya beberapa perusahaan private sektor itu sudah bersertifikat RSPO. Misalnya tadi seperti Ibu dari Wilmar itu sudah punya sertifikat RSPO, ada ASEAN Agri, ada beberapa KUD, misalnya KUD Dosan juga sudah bersertifikat RSPO. Ada lagi yang koperasi yang beringin jaya. Ini adalah koperasi yang kebunnya di kawasan gambut. Jadi salah satunya pengelolaan perkebunan di kawasan gambut yang punya sertifikat RSPO. Ini dikelola oleh koperasi. Ini juga menunjukkan kepedulian dari masyarakat itu cukup tinggi. Kemudian the last but not the least, misalnya ekonomi Kabupaten Siak. Kita lihat PDRB Siak itu. PDRB Siak itu yang pertama adalah pertambangan dan penggalian. Itu 23,44% berkontribusi. Kemudian pertanian ada 23,19%. Kemudian industri pengolahan. Yang industri pengolahan ini juga notabene-nya adalah industri-industri CPO, industri-industri kehutanan seperti pulp and paper. Itu 41,77%. Jadi total 88,40% dari ekonomi Siak itu adalah based on natural resources gitu. Jadi kalau kita enggak peduli terhadap lingkungan, bayangkan ekonomi Siak. Jadi itu kenapa Kabupaten Siak itu perlu ada kebijakan tentang Siak Hijau. Lanjut, Pak. Nah, kalau kita lihat, lanjut, next. Slide.
Lanjut, Pak. Ya. Silakan lanjut.
Slide okay. Selanjutnya. Kalau kita lihat komitmen Pemkab Siak tadi tentang Kabupaten Siak Hijau, kenapa Kabupaten misalnya mendorong prinsip-prinsip kelestarian dan berkelanjutan dalam pemanfaatan sumber daya alam dan peningkatan ekonomi masyarakat itu kita wadahi melalui awalnya adalah melalui Perbup nomor 22 tahun 2018 tentang Siak Hijau. Nah, sekarang on progress kita sedang menyusun perdanya. Jadi akan segera disampaikan kepada DPRD untuk kesepakatan bersama tentang peraturan daerahnya. Nah, tujuan Siak Hijau itu seperti yang kami sampaikan tadi, kenapa kita membuat Siak Hijau? Yang pertama, pengelolaan sumber daya alam untuk kepentingan masyarakat dengan prinsip kelestarian dan keberlanjutan. Jadi kita ingin menonjolkan lestari dan berlanjut, itu sustainable. Kemudian yang kedua, kepentingan masyarakat dalam pemanfaatan sumber daya alam untuk meningkatkan ekonomi dan pendapatan asli daerah. Yang ketiga tujuannya, goalnya adalah pola pemanfaatan sumber daya alam daerah melalui kegiatan perlindungan, hilirisasi, dan intensifikasi. Jadi kita ekstensifikasinya belakangkan gitu.
Iya.
Kemudian dari
Pak Wan, Perbup
Siak Hijau itu, halo.
Pak Wan, mohon maaf, kami waktu memang sudah terbatas, Bapak. Kalau berkenan, kami akan pindah ke Pak Surin untuk menjelaskan dari perspektif beliau.
Nanti
kita bisa lanjuti, Pak Wan. Mohon maaf, Pak.
Iya.
Terima kasih, Pak Wan, atas pengalamannya. Selanjutnya kami persilakan Pak Surin untuk menyampaikan presentasinya. Silakan, Pak Surin.
Terima kasih Pak Agus dan mohon maaf ya Pak Wan karena
menjelaskan. Ya, mohon maaf Pak Wan.
Juga saya ingin mohon maaf Pak, presentasi saya dalam bahasa Inggris.
Kami silakan Pak Surin.
Sebab sebenarnya saya boleh betul dalam bahasa Indonesia, cuma takut ada apa certain terma yang tidak begitu apa align ya antara bahasa Indonesia dengan bahasa Indonesia. Jadi saya langsung ya dalam bahasa Inggris ya. Okay. So thank you everyone. So the topic that was given to me was on the enabling conditions. Based on enabling conditions for jurisdictional approach based on the experience in Malaysia and also Indonesia. So so we have identified some of these key enabling conditions based on the experience in by Proforest and our partner Demeter Consulting in implementing this landscape initiative in Indonesia, specifically the Siap Pelalawan landscape initiative. Also, we have initiated another initiative in Sungai Lineau, also in Riau province. And then in Malaysia, although Proforest has not been working directly on landscape initiatives on the ground, but we have also been following closely the developments of the Sabah jurisdictional approach as explained by Pep earlier, Josh from Wilma. So we can share some of the knowledge that we have gained. So basically, when it comes to enabling condition, there are several that are important. For example, having the relevant policy instruments at the national or local level. And this is basically from the government side. So there must be policies that are aligned with sustainability and also on certification and sustainability and so on. The political will must be there, as we can see from our colleagues involved in this forum, both at the national level and also at the regional level, where it's only with their support that we can actually implement sustainable or landscape initiatives. And of course, the budget must be there. I think several of the previous panelists have also mentioned the importance of having the budgetary commitment and also the presence of multi-stakeholder platform. And this is what I would like to discuss a little bit more, which is the importance of having a multi-stakeholder platform to allow for cross-learning, constructive dialogue, and also collective or strategic decision-making. So this has proven to be very critical in terms of moving the initiative. And as I mentioned before, the government support is also key. And you can see from the photos where we have done the initiative, we have got support from the government, and this could be in the form of a collaborative or cooperation agreement. It could be in the form of MOU, support letter, physical presence during events. Like here, we can see that there's a lot of support from the government sector. So these are all really important in terms of allowing for the landscape initiative or the jurisdictional initiative to be implemented on the ground. So next, please. So for Proforest and also our partner, Demeter Consulting, we have been working very closely with the private sector because we are bringing in the support from the supply chain to the initiatives on the ground. So some of these companies may be downstream companies, and these are some of the brands that we are familiar with, but basically they want to support transformation on the ground where the, you know, we have this collaboration in order to improve smallholder livelihoods, to improve productivity, and also to improve sustainability and alignment with NDP and so on.
So we'll almost finish, Pak Surin. Thank
yes,
you so much.
I will wrap up soon. So another really important element is to have a neutral facilitator in order to coordinate amongst all the different players. We need that multi-stakeholder engagement. Next, please. And the last slide. So just to mention some of the benefits of the jurisdictional landscape approach, and we have benefits for companies, smallholders, and the government sector. we don't usually highlight too much things like premium and monetary incentives because those things may take some time before they become a reality. But even during the process itself, you can already gain some benefits, especially in terms of improved collaboration, opportunities for capacity building and sharing of knowledge and resources, enhanced reputation and confidence. And for the smallholders also, a sense of pride in terms of what they're doing, their farming efforts, you know, to feel that they are part of the supply chain that is supplying products to other consumers around the world. I think all these are non-tangible benefits that we can talk about when we are engaging at the jurisdictional landscape level. So with that, I end my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Pak Surian, for your kind presentation. Next would be our colleague, Pak Santo Kurniawan. Kami persilakan, Pak Santo.
Baik, selamat sore untuk kita semua. Salam sehat kepada Bapak-Bapak, Ibu-Ibu sekalian. Saya akan mempresentasikan lesson learned on the institutional development of GR di SIA. Sebelum perkenalkan, saya Sedawo SIA, konsorsium NGO yang mendukung inisiatif SIA Kabupaten Hijau. Tiga overview presentasi yang akan saya sampaikan. Pertama, proses dan peran dalam memfasilitasi kebijakan SIA Hijau. Yang kedua, bagaimana kebijakan SIA Hijau diterjemahkan dalam peta jalan atau roadmap kegiatan-kegiatan yang ada di Kabupaten SIA. Nah, yang ketiga, apa yang mungkin masih diperlukan dalam mencapai SIA Hijau dan memperkuat peran stakeholder lainnya di Kabupaten SIA. Kira-kira overview presentasinya itu. Nah, saya mulai dari proses fasilitasi kebijakan SIA Hijau. Bahwa dengan kondisi yang ada di Provinsi Riau, kami perlu mencari champion kabupaten yang bisa menerapkan prinsip kabupaten hijau, menjawab masalah-masalah yang terjadi. Gitu. Kemudian SIA Hijau bentuk JA yang menerapkan tata kelola pembangunan yang berprinsip keseimbangan ekonomi, sosial, dan lingkungan. Kemudian dalam konteks ekosistem mendukung itu ada modalitas SIA. Salah satunya adalah di SIA itu ada namanya Semenanjung Kampar, lahan gambut yang terluas itu yang di Sumatera, di Semenanjung Kampar itu di Kabupaten SIA dan Kabupaten Pelawan. Kemudian dukungan Bapreya untuk komitmen keberlanjutan Kabupaten SIA, Kabupaten SIA mengelola sumber daya alam dan meningkatkan ekonomi masyarakat, kemudian rantai pasok di SIA. Nah, proses fasilitasi yang kemudian kita lakukan itu dalam kaitan lingkup hidup, bagaimana lingkup hidup yang baik, kemudian penghidupan ekonomi masyarakat. Satu hal yang penting juga di dalam kerja-kerja SIA Kabupaten Hijau itu perlu kerja bersama. Karena bicara lingkungan hidup adalah bicara tentang semua pihak, dan itu yang kemudian dipraktekkan dalam kegiatan-kegiatan yang ada di Kabupaten SIA. Kemudian kami juga selain melakukan sosialisasi kepada para pihak gitu, juga sosialisasi sampai ke tingkat di kecamatan bersama dengan pemerintah tentunya. Kemudian kita membentuk koalisi privat sektor yang kita namakan KPPSH, koalisi privat sektor untuk SIA Hijau, ini bersama pemerintah. Kemudian juga kita membentuk komunitas-komunitas SIA Hijau, ada guru TK, taman kanak-kanak, kemudian komunitas anak motor, komunitas-komunitas seniman, segala macam, yang kemudian kita mendiskusikan kaitan dengan penting semua pihak mendukung siap Kabupaten Hijau. Kemudian kita juga melakukan engage dengan privat sektor. Nah, pengalaman kami dari apa yang dilakukan di Kabupaten Siak itu, sebelum kemudian kita meminta atau bersama-sama dengan pemerintah meminta para pihak itu masuk dalam kesepahaman terkait dengan Siak itu.
Pak Santo, ya. Sudah kan berakhir Pak Santo, mungkin kalau boleh dipercepat Pak Santo. Okay, Terima kasih. Pak Santo langsung.
Baik, mungkin bisa dilanjut. Ya. Nah, ini kaitan dengan bagaimana kebijakan Siak Hijau itu diterjemahkan. Pertama ada visi misi bupati, kemudian ada program prioritas. Nah, di salah satu misinya bupati kaitan dengan pembangunan berkelanjutan ada program kaitan dengan roadmap Siak Hijau. Program itu yang kemudian diimplementasikan di tingkat tingkat implementator gitu, dengan kegiatan-kegiatan kaitan dengan roadmap. Roadmap itu ada pendekatan zona, jadi perlu ada intervensi di masing-masing zona. Kemudian biar ini implementatif itu harus disinergikan dengan rencana strategiknya dinas-dinas. Kemudian mensinergikan dengan mitra-mitra pembangunan. Nah, semua itu yang kemudian diramu jadi pedoman roadmap. Kemudian kita evaluasi dan kami bersama dengan pemerintah membuat web Siak Hijau, di sana memuat pekerjaan kita masing-masing dan evaluasi dari apa yang kami lakukan.
Baik, Bapak.
Kemudian ini kaitan dengan peluang penguatan para pihak. Kemitraan para pihak itu menjadi suatu hal yang penting dilakukan. Kemudian beberapa hal yang terkait dengan mendukung Siak Kabupaten Hijau. Kemudian ada beberapa yang kemudian bisa dilakukan, misalnya terkait dengan Tora, terkait dengan tanah objek reforma agraria, dan kebakaran hutan lahan yang kemudian menjadi konsen ke depan bisa dilakukan secara bersama. Saya pikir itu, Pak, terima kasih. Salam buat semua. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih Pak Santo atas kesempatan diberikan kepada memberikan pembelajaran kepada kami semua, Pak Santo. Terima kasih. Selanjutnya kami persilakan ada mungkin pertanyaan, dan ini adalah saya dapat dari Pak Nyoman. Ini kami tujukan mungkin kepada Pak Wan. Beliau menyebutkan bahwa keberadaan perkebunan sawit akasia di lahan gambut sangat perlu dipetakan ulang. Ya, dari beberapa kondisi lapangan, kebun sawit di gambut, terutama Sumatera dan Kalimantan, mengalami subsiden yang mengkhawatirkan dan sering terbakar. Pertanyaan adalah seberapa jauh pemerintah Kabupaten Siak dapat mengantisipasi keberlanjutan perkebunan sawit di lahan gambut mengingat permasalahan ekologis yang cukup serius, Bapak. Karena beliau memandang bahwa saya tidak yakin bahwa sertifikasi RSPO maupun ISPO dapat mengatasi permasalahan ini, misalnya, Bapak.
Baik, Pak Agus.
Ya.
Kedengaran suara saya, Pak?
Bisa, Pak. Silakan, Pak Wan.
Ya, mudah-mudahan nggak masalah lagi. Jadi untuk perkebunan gambut, jadi kebijakan dari Pemkab Siak tidak ada lagi penambahan lahan sawit, terutama untuk izin perkebunan baru. Jadi bukan hanya di lahan gambut, yang tidak lahan gambut pun tidak ada lagi penambahan izin baru untuk perkebunan. Nah, yang kami sampaikan tadi, bahwa ada operasi yang mendapatkan RSPO itu adalah kebun yang sudah ada sejak dulu, Pak. Jadi oleh masyarakat, ingin mengelolanya secara lingkungan, mereka mengurus supaya dia mendapatkan RSPO. Jadi kan tidak mungkin kebun-kebun masyarakat itu mau kita musnahkan. Tapi yang kebijakan yang ada sekarang adalah tidak ada lagi penambahan lagi perkebunan di lahan gambut maupun tidak gambut. Jadi tidak ada izin baru, Pak. Gitu. Jadi mudah-mudahan ini kebijakan ini bisa menyelamatkan lingkungan. Nah, untuk yang lahan-lahan perkebunan masyarakat yang masih di lahan gambut, ini juga menjadi bahan studi kita ke depan itu bagaimana, itu masih dalam penyelidikan kita, dalam studi kita. Demikian, Pak Gus.
Baik, terima kasih Pak Wan. Ini ada juga pertanyaan dari Pak Ibu Jini Eng, mungkin terkait dengan kita, panel kita, Pak ya. Intinya beliau menanyakan apakah ada industri lain selain dari palm oil yang tertarik untuk bidang jurisdictional approach khususnya yang ada di SIAP, Pak? Terima kasih. Ini pertanyaan kepada juga Pak Santo ataupun Pak sama Pak Wan. Terima kasih.
Ya, mungkin ada, Pak, tapi kita belum menginventarisir. Tapi industri yang berkembang di Kabupaten Siak itu adalah palm oil, kemudian industri yang pulp and paper yang besar-besar, kemudian industri-industri yang kayu lapis itu sudah nggak ada lagi, Pak. Kalau dulu ada, sekarang sudah mulai ada, karena kayunya, bahan bakunya sudah tak ada. Kemudian industri-industri lain, ya belum berkembang, Pak. Itu yang ada di Kabupaten Siak.
Baik, Pak. Mungkin ada tanggapan dari Pak Santo? Kami kurang lebih sampai pukul kurang lebih 5 menit lagi kalau ada.
Bagus, kalau boleh saya
pun. Silakan Pak Surin,
kami persilakan. Tambahan sedikit ya. Jadi coba. Untuk inisiatif di Sungai Linau, ada juga terlibat industri pulp and paper juga. Ya, jadi bukan sawit saja yang terlibat. Terima kasih.
Baik Pak, terima kasih. Ada pertanyaan dari floor online, Pak Santo mungkin akan menambahkan. Oke. Baik Pak, mungkin kalau jadi pertanyaan terakhir mungkin yang bisa saya sampaikan adalah ada di pernyataan dari Pak Santo. Sebentar, mohon maaf. Yang menyatakan bahwa kebijakan Siak Hijau sebagai wujud jurisdictional approach itu masih bersifat mekanisme tidak tertulis tata kelola pembangunan di Kabupaten Siak. Apakah sekiranya kebijakan yang tidak tertulis tersebut bisa dijadikan yang tertulis dan mengingat semua pihak dalam bentuk perda? Ini pertanyaan kepada saya, kemungkinan Pak Wan dan Pak Santo juga. Terima kasih. Dan sebelum saya akhiri.
Jadi mungkin sebelum Pak Santo tadi juga, karena waktunya mepet sekali tadi, kami sampaikan perbup tentang komitmen Pemkab Siak terhadap Kabupaten Siak Hijau ini akan segera diperdakan, Pak. Baik, kemudian Pak. Kami juga menyampaikan tadi bahwa dari perbup Siak Hijau itu lahir roadmap Siak Hijau, kemudian juga kami menyusun rencana pelindungan dan pengelolaan lingkungan hidup, RPPLH. Baik. Nanti dari itu akan turun ke RPJMD Siak 2021-2026. Nah, dari RPJMD Siak ini akan RPJMD Siak perda, Pak. Kemudian baik, Pak. Turun menjadi Renstra OPD, kemudian dari pemerintah desa yang di Siak itu namanya kampung, akan lahir rencana pembangunan jangka menengah kampung. Nah, baik, juga Pak. Berdasarkan RPJMD Siak. Jadi artinya tadi Siak Kabupaten Hijau itu sudah meresap sampai ke kampung-kampung, Pak. Nanti dari RPJMD kampung akan mereka menjadi dasar atau pijakan untuk menyusun anggaran pendapatan dan belanja kampung. Jadi anggaran belanja kampung itu dasarnya RPJM kampung, RPJM kampung dasarnya adalah RPJMD Siak. Demikian juga OPD. OPD dinas-dinas yang ada di Kabupaten Siak itu renstranya akan membuat rencana kerja setiap tahun. Jadi ini semua sudah tertulis, Pak.
Baik, Pak. Terima kasih sekali, Bapak. Pak Santo, sebelum apa ada pernyataan sebelum
ya,
saya
menambah sedikit aja dari Pak Wan gitu. Jadi memang itu yang sebagaimana tadi sampaikan Pak Wan bahwa ke depan akan ada perda Siak Kabupaten Siak Hijau. Kami sedang Siak salah satu yang kemudian diminta pemerintah Siak ya Pak Wan dan kawan-kawan itu di pemerintah Siak untuk membantu memberikan masukan terkait dengan rencana draft perda itu. Nah, menurut saya menarik kemudian kalau JA dalam konteks menjadi mekanisme tata kelola pembangunan Siak itu tertulis gitu, dan itu yang nanti ke depan bisa mungkin bersama Pak Wan dan tim pemerintah Kabupaten Siak mendiskusikan kira-kira poin apa yang kemudian bisa dimasukkan untuk menjawab sebagaimana tadi Pak Agus sampaikan. Saya pikir itu. Makasih, ya.
Pak. Terima kasih sekali Pak Santo bagi akhiri juga suatu ada arah yang yang jelas baik kedua pihak khususnya di perkembangan di Siak. Bapak Ibu sekalian, mohon maaf karena waktu juga saya ingin berikan catatan untuk diskusi panel kedua ini. Yang pertama saya akan mencatat bahwa kebijakan pertumbuhan hijau yang dilakukan oleh Kabupaten Siak telah menunjukkan komitmen dari pemerintah daerah sendiri. bahwa roadmap dan rencana aksi Bapak Ibu sekalian perlu ditindaklanjuti secara kolektif ya di dalam anggota jurisdictional approach sehingga target kolektif yang ditetapkan baik oleh pemerintah daerah Kabupaten Siak maupun nasional juga bisa tercapai. Kemudian pemerintah daerah membutuhkan tetap dukungan kolektif dari mitra terkait untuk mencapai target kolektif bahwa target dan komitmen sektor swasta masyarakat mandani harus diintegrasikan ke dalam roadmap dan rencana aksi pertumbuhan hijau. Demikian pula khusus untuk mewujudkan komitmen terhadap rantai pasokan hanya dapat dicapai melalui kerja kolaboratif yang melibatkan pemangku kepentingan yang terkait di dalam wilayah yurisdiksi seperti yang disampaikan oleh Pak Surin tadi. Demikian Bapak-Ibu sekalian, ringkasan dan sajian untuk panel yang kedua. Waktu dan kesempatan kami serahkan kembali kepada Pak Rizal. Terima kasih. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Salam. Waalaikumsalam. Thank you Pak Agus Lukman dan juga kepada Bapak-Bapak panelis di panel 2. Sangat senang mendengar progres yang sangat maju ya untuk siap pelalawan. Terima kasih Bapak-Bapak semua.
Welcome, jadi, Pak Rizal.
The roadmap and action plans need to be followed up collectively within the jurisdictional approach coalition members that would deliver sustainable and deforestation-free supply chain commitments by way of collaborative works that involves all the related stakeholders within the producer jurisdiction or landscape. So thank you so much, Bapak. Now it's time to do reflections. The policy framework, commitments, and agenda of jurisdictional approach cannot be a standalone initiative because they will always be related to the context of political economy developed by the national government. Let's hear some reflections from key practitioners from the perspective of producer, business and finance enabler, and governance. Let me give the floor first to Pak Dennis Munang. He is the Chief Sustainability Officer of DSN Group. The floor is yours, Pak Dennis. Thank you.
Terima kasih, Pak Rizal. And terima kasih kepada all the panelists who spoke before me. Just maybe a bit of background, yeah. Unlike Wilma atau GA, which is infinitely huge compared to DSNG, DSNG is a small and medium-sized Indonesian palm oil company based in Indonesia. Yeah, we have 125,000 hectares planted in tea and plasma with 10 mills. Yeah, so my perspective comes from DSNG because you know we are small in our terms, and in our perspective, it's important, I think, for businesses to be open or to be incentivized to off-concession conservation in the landscape where their supply chain operate. But to be honest, I sense that this type of work is very unfamiliar territory for businesses like us, right? We're medium-sized. I heard Pak Agus speak eloquently about how GA was asked the question whether they can afford not to be involved in a jurisdictional approach, but you know, for small companies and companies like us, you know, it's unfamiliar territory, yeah. And what I mean unfamiliar territory is off concession conservation, which is part of the jurisdictional approach. Now, in our case, right. We're a little bit unique. Sebab kenapa our stakeholders have expressed strong interest to look at off-concession conservation areas. Yeah, and what I mean is one of our stakeholders is NGreen, of course, who has given us funding. Right, we source about 16% of our supply base from external sources. Yeah, it's not very big, but it's still substantial. And because of this interest that NGreen has, we are piloting a scheme where we are looking at an off-concession conservation area of approximately, tidak besar, 3,500 hectares, right, in East Kalimantan. This is the first time we are doing it, right? And we plan to work, of course, with many stakeholders, as in what you'll find in the jurisdictional approach, local communities, local governments, our own supply chain, an NGO, and also who bring in specialist skills, right? And as well as we want to also work with our downstream supply chain that we sell up to, you know. We want them to understand what we do and how complicated it is. So they act as verifiers. Now, in our case, we are indeed blessed because we already have this commitment, right, with NGreen in our sustainable funding to move to this approach of concession, conservation area, yeah, where we work to bring inclusivity to our farmers. And like Ibu Pep said, you know, when you strip out everything about certification, we're just talking about best practices. And also, not to increase any other areas for and risk any more areas for deforestation. But my question has always been is, what will incentivize or move companies, you know, similar size to us or even smaller, to move to support off concession conservation areas? Yeah. So I would say the difficulties is this, right? Companies such as us find it difficult to design and incorporate stakeholders in certain jurisdictional approach, mainly because of two things. Yeah. And number one is this, because this is something new, we are finding, right, this is based on our experience, we need specialist skills, yeah, knowledge and experience within the organization that could help design, manage, implement, as well as monitor and verify all of what we're doing, this conservation approach, outside our concession. You know, we do very well inside our concession. Cuma outside, it's beyond our area. You know, kita bukan pemerintah, right? So this is very difficult. So what we've had to do is we've had to hire people who are previously from NGO to help us with this, to help understand and bridge this with our existing management, right? But the second problem, not a problem, but challenge, is also getting commitment from various stakeholders, right? This is a new challenge for us. Working.
Pak Dennis, apology. You have less than 1 minute left, Pak Dennis.
And working with government supply chain. And the big part of this problem is this, and I heard this, you know, a lot of the areas where there's compliance issue is a legacy deforestation where smallholders have already moved in. You know, how do we move them in terms of land legality? You know, if we can solve a big part of that, and we don't know how to do that, small companies like don't know how to do that, and we need help. Yeah. So that's from me, Pak Rizal, and to my fellow panelists. I hope that was useful. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Pak Dennis. Let's hear the reflection from Pak Widar Mika Agung. He's the director of Systemic. Pak Widar, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Yes, Pak Rizal. Thank you. I think it's an honor to be in this forum and to learn from all the distinguished speakers and responders. Let me start by introducing a little bit about Systemic as a context of my reflection. Systemic is a system change company that works with businesses, financial institutions, that, you know, and nonprofit organizations to accelerate the creations of a more sustainable economic system that creates prosperity for all. And this the learnings that I'll share is based on our experience in taking part in incubating regenerative business model in Indonesia, right? Regenerative business model in for us is companies with a business model whereby as the business grow, the forest coverage will increase as well, right? And I think so that's as a context. And it's interesting to hear all the panelists and throughout this forum. I guess my take is that I think a lot of the approach in jurisdictional is around greening the existing supply chain by, you know, as I think some of the panelists mentioned, is through, you know, getting certifications and implementing best practices, right? And I think a lot of it, like, mainly working through existing big players, and I think that's the right thing to do because of the impact immediate impact that it can deliver, right? I think worth thinking of different angles. I think which is, you know, how do you in jurisdictions? The end goal is creating a greener economy, right? I guess trying to see from different angles whereby, you know, beyond greening the existing supply chains through the existing players, what are the other approach, right? The other approach meaning can we create new kind of companies then can become the backbone for these new green economies in these jurisdictions? And we see that in two ways. We from our incubations, we look at this. Usually the new type of companies comes in two ways. One is are those companies that create values by maintaining the forest standing, right? So, and number two is companies that are creating values by, increasing the forest coverage. So these two are very new companies. So it's kind of a different approach. And the one example I think in the landscape that we work on is Forest Wise. It's a company that we work and incubate. It's basically they take ilipe nut from Tengkawang trees, they create an ilipe butter, and they sell it to cosmetic companies. So that create jobs and incomes to this communities in Kuburaya, right? And therefore keep the forest standing. So I think it's interesting I think it's a food for thought for everyone here. I think the proponents of jurisdictional approach is to see whether whether there's a role or how to increase the role of creations of these new kind of businesses that can increase the value of forest standing, or then can create values by increasing the numbers of forest standing in creating a new greener economy. That's number one. Number two is around, while also looking at the way to greening the existing kind of supply commodities, the existing supply chains, is to look at with a different angle whereby is there any opportunities to create new companies that can solve the problem faster, right? So for example, I think from DSN, I think mentioned there's a challenge of creating capabilities in terms of conservations outside of their own concessions, right? So is there a company, is there an opportunity to create a business around that can become a vehicles that can solve similar problems to similar companies? And we've also worked with, I think, the likes of, I think maybe some of the audience here have heard about Lestari Capital, for example. That's kind of a different kind of approach. It's a business that tried to help existing kind of players to fasten, speed up in terms of the greening process of the supply chain. So I guess those are kind of my two reflections. And I do believe that the government can play a key role in this, right? As in the heart of jurisdictional approach, because I think, again, to look at elements beyond supply chains, existing supply chains, we see in building new businesses, right? To greening the existing commodities or to create businesses beyond the existing commodities, the government can play a role because key things are, we found, one is talent is important. If you want to build businesses.
Thank you.
Yes. All right. So I guess, I think, let me close it there. Thank you, Pak Riza.
Thank you, Pak Widar. Let me turn to my friend, former colleague, Pak Wahyudi Wardoyo. He is the senior advisor of Yayasan Konservasi Alam Nusantara, formerly known as the Nature Conservancy. He is also known as the father of jurisdictional approach. So it will be really interesting to hear your thoughts, Pak Wahyudi. The floor is yours, Pak. Terima kasih.
Yeah. Thank you, Pak Riza. Pak Riza was my boss in TNC Indonesia program and also Jekan for a while before he moved to TFA. secondly, I'm not the father of jurisdiction approach of the GA. But by listening the discussion and also presentation, I think there are some points that I like also to share to all of you. First, seems to me that we have to agree what does it means by jurisdictional approach, because some of us here in Iran seems to me still not clear about the jurisdictional approach. And what is the link between jurisdictional approach and landscapes approach, as also mentioned by Ba Akusari before? I think it's, this is very, very crucial, Lisa and friends. To my understanding, traditional approach is a new approach that actually more rational and more implementable compared to landscape approach. Why? Because if we see landscape approach, then we can see the small landscape, we can see bigger landscape, and one landscape can be divided into several districts or bupaten or even provincial boundary. So that's why we have to understand first about the jurisdictional approach, because again, if we use landscape approach, we cannot get any one sustainable or one set of infrastructure for governing the landscapes, because the landscape can be divided into 2, 3, 4, 5 kabupaten or even provincial government. But under the jurisdictional approach, like kabupaten, we can have a set of hard infrastructure and soft infrastructure. So that's why we can define who will do what and when and where. So that's why under the jurisdictional approach, we can do for not just for government, but also for private sectors, for smallholders or stakeholders, NGO, and so on. The most important thing under the jurisdiction approach, we have to apply good governance. Why? And the good governance, if I may say, at least there are four out of 7 or 8. To me, participation, transparency, accountability, and responsibility is the key requirements for jurisdictional approach. And by doing so, we can set up what we call measurement of the good governance in each of the stakeholders, whether government, whether private sectors, whether communities, and so on. So that's why by doing so, then we can do what you call gotong royong, collaborative action. Because by seeing the level of governance, then we can improve or even probably promote that approach. And I think it's by traditional governance, we can use as a kind of modalities to be used as measurement of our goals. Because again, as Rudy mentioned from Bappenas, the goals of everything to do in this practice is low carbon economic development. So, and also measurable. So by doing so, jurisdictional approach, to my understanding, is will be much, much better compared to landscape approach. And we can use whether a kabupaten or provincial, it's more complicated for provincial, but also we can also use landscape approach. We start from a small one, villages, what you can do in noise, starting from villages and then strengthen into district, and to some extent, we also support provincial government. For instance, when we set up which area has to be protected because the proxy is must be protected, and in which area we have opportunity to develop as the plantation. So the approach we call development by design. And YEKAN is doing so to support Papeda Kalimantan Timur, and from several plantation companies, they receive a kind of commitment, more than 600,000 hectares of high conservation value of forests under plantation will not be cut because of the T approach. Meaning that by development, by design, we can see which one is the proxy has to be protected and which area can be converted into
Thank you.
Other.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Pak Yedi. Very impressive, and noted about your remarks on that development by is going to be an interesting subject on our next discussion to really advance jurisdictional approach. Let me turn to my colleague, Pak Justin Adams. He is the Executive Director of Tropical Forest Alliance, to give his quick reflections, and then we will close Ino from PISAGRO. Pak Justin, welcome. Thank you, Pak.
Pak Rizal, terima kasih. Selamat sore, everybody. It's a great pleasure to be here and to participate and to listen to your discussions. You don't need me to tell you the urgency of action regarding climate change. The IPCC reports and the conclusions from that make only too clear the absolute critical need for action in the very near term to address the very real challenges of climate change. But it's also, how do we support rural communities and ensure green development at the local kabupaten level and the provincial level, not just in Indonesia, but all around the world and all around the tropical forest countries in the world in particular. And what I'm really inspired by today is how much work is going on, how much thinking is going on in Indonesia, because the other thing that the world needs today is not solutions designed centrally or globally in London or in Washington. They need solutions that are built and developed at the local level and are owned by the local stakeholders. And so what is really inspiring for me is to see these organizations coming together and looking at how do you find the solutions that are appropriate in particular landscapes. The example from SEAC I find particularly inspiring, but I know so many examples going on across Indonesia owned by stakeholders. And I think that is really, really important. I'm also delighted to learn this new phrase, Gotong Royong, which is not just collective action, but it is that sense of mutual responsibility, if I understand that correctly, of how you can work together. And so again, I would encourage all of you to look at how you work together, how you support one another as different organizations with so much to bring to the communities, to the companies, to the local governments that need to work and find new pathways to develop. And that is where I think Indonesia can lead, where all of you can lead at a time when the world so desperately needs it. So thank you for putting this meeting on. Thank you for working together and demonstrating Gotong Royong in practice. Please bring that message to the world, and anything we can do to help, I will be only too delighted. Terima kasih.
Thank you, Pak Justin. Great views and perspective on the significance of Gotong Royong. We will surely take that offer of Gotong Royong globally. And now over to Pak Insan Shafat. He's the Executive Director for PISAGRO to provide us with the closing remarks, next step, first jurisdiction collective action forum. Pak Insan, over to you. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Pak Rizal. Allow me to speak in English, Bapak-Bapak and Ibu-Ibu. Good afternoon. First, I'd like to thank TFA for bringing us to join this forum, joined by esteemed colleagues, friends, partners in the spirit of Gotong Royong. I'd like to congratulate everyone for who's participated today and has shared your expertise, your knowledge, your examples, your experience about what jurisdictional approaches are and why they should be done through multi-stakeholder participations at one commodity or across sector or commodities. Echoing Pak Deputy, jurisdictional approach should be then to pursue sustainable commodity productions, low carbon developments, and eventually to contribute to the SDGs. For me, you all being here is a proof of that. So hope that we can all use this forum to show your strong commitments, support, consistent participations to realize our definitions of the state of jurisdictional approaches. Just this afternoon, we saw and heard just how far we have shown our interest in this approach. I think from all the sessions today highlighted that there are significant roles of the jurisdiction leaders, businesses, financiers, right, CSOs, to advance the commitments of sustainable commodity productions. We also have heard today that there are business cases already from the privates, enabling commitments, enabling support, regulations from the districts, from the governments. These are the key elements of a jurisdictional multi-stakeholder approach. And it is the shared understanding for the effective, implementations. We also recognize how important it is to promote the existing initiatives and also to scale up the approach. Despite all the challenges that were identified this afternoon, it is wonderful to see that there are opportunities, right? For instance, it was mentioned today about a long-term financial plan or low-risk sourcing processes, commodities. So I believe that through this Gotong Royong collective actions together in this forum, we still have more work to do, more collaborations to explore, and more hopefully for the greater impacts to create. So this may be the first dialogues, but I'm sure, and I can speak on behalf of everyone here in this forum, that there were many, many further ideas and work to follow moving forward. So as we all know, it was mentioned by Pak Rizal that JCAF will be a series of dialogues. The next one will be happening in September, end of September, I think. What can we expect? Some interesting topics from what we heard today, such as, you know, dive even deeper on the development of business cases, agreed definitions, probably our Indonesian guidelines of the jurisdictional approaches, and many, many more. Policy brief, for instance. So I'm sure this forum will also bring more interesting speaker with specific expertise as well. And then as Justin, Justin just said, let's use this forum to encourage, to look one another, to bring message to the world of that, of what Indonesia can bring in to the table, right? So therefore, let's keep our spirit. Let's constantly show our support and constructive contribution. And moreover, let's work together to create and collaborate to advance the digital approach. Thank you. Congratulations again, friends and partners. Thank you for your time today. I hope to see you all at the end of September. Good evening.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Have a safe trip.
Thank you, everyone.
Yeah, have a safe trip.
Thank you, everyone. Bye bye.
Thank you, everyone. Stay safe.
Stay safe.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Bye.
Bye, Pak Surin. Thank you, Pak Surin. Pak Ino.
Thank you, Pak Surin. Hope to see you again, Pak Surin. Ya.
Ya, terima kasih. Pak Agus,
Pak Yudi, Pak Arifin. Terima kasih banyak, Pak Aldi. Pak Agus.
Pak Yudi, terima kasih banyak, Bapak.
Sangat-sangat.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
Ini lagunya mood untuk after party katanya.
Ini udah siap, Pak. Tequila. Udah siap tequila di sini. Tequila sama Chitos.
Don't start.
Job. Woi, masih ada tamu itu.
Gak apa-apa lah, Bapak bukan tamu lah, Pak.
I only have a mouthwash.
I only have hand sanitizer. Ini kita dapat bekal.